Hello and welcome to the second lesson of this Introduction to Probability of Wolfram U. Today, we talk combinatorics. Let's begin. Randomness is often portrayed as flipping a coin or tossing a die. For a coin, the chance or probability of getting tails is 1 over 2, while getting a 6 with a die is rarer, 1 over 6. But what is this 1 over something number? Well, it's the number of outcomes. Counting the number of outcomes to an experiment is often sufficient to find its probability. Combinatorial analysis is just that, the branch of mathematics focused on efficient ways of counting. Consider two simultaneous experiments, A and B, that have m and n possible outcomes, respectively. Then there are m times n possible outcomes to the two experiments together. It's quite intuitive, really. For example, tossing two dice with six faces each results in 36 outcomes. Six for the rows, six for the columns. Generalizing the principle, consider k experiments of each n outcomes. The number of outcomes can be calculated by n times, and so on, k times, so n power k. Counting simultaneous experiments is now solved. Let's move on to sequential experiments. How many ways are there to enumerate n different objects? Permutations address this issue. Let's say you choose a book out of n books to be the first one you read. Then you have n minus 1 books remaining. If you choose another book, then you now have n minus 2 books remaining. And so on until one book remains. Then the number of orderings is n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 and so on down to 1. This is called factorial n. It's written with an exclamation point at the end. If you only want to order I books, then you stop at n minus I plus 1, which can also be written in this way mathematically. So let's take an example. Imagine 4 Swiss and 5 Ethiopian athletes competing. If you rank them all, then you choose 9, and then 8, and then 7, and so on until 1, so 9 factorial. If separated into two groups, then there are 4 factorial and 5 factorial, multiplied because there are two different events, so simultaneous. If you only want 3 winners out of 9, then you just count 9 times 8 times 7. Now, consider you choose I unordered objects out of n objects. What is the number of different groups of I objects? Like permutations, the objects are taken, not replaced. Unlike permutations, objects are unordered, so we must find a way to ignore ordering. So let's think about this for a second. Each ordering is counted I factorial times. Thus, the number of outcomes is the number of permutations only divided by I factorial. And indeed, it's the case. The number of groups is this mathematical formula, or the binomial for short. We just discovered the binomial coefficient. Bi stands for 2, and it's for 2 groups, a group of I objects and a group of n minus I objects. This formula is basically the number of orderings of the entire group of size n divided by the number of orderings of the relevant group, size I, and the irrelevant group, size n minus I. Imagine the same athletes form a team of 5. The size of the total group is 9, but the team has a size of 5, so it's binomial 9-5. If you require 3 of them to be Swiss and 2 Ethiopians, then you end up with 2 binomial coefficients, as we saw with multiple simultaneous experiments. Choosing I elements out of n can equivalently be phrased as choosing if someone is in the group or is not. Consider x means one person is in the group, and y meaning that same person is not in the group. Then the situation can be mathematically expressed as x plus y power n. Let's simplify the case where n is equal to 2. With a bit of algebra, this naturally generates all possible binomial coefficients for n is equal to 2. The binomial theorem generalizes this for all n. For example, consider n is equal to 5. then we can use the binomial theorem and we end up with all the possible coefficients, which is actually true if you expand the entire thing. As a side note, binomial coefficients can be expressed as a recursive sum starting at 1, and this is called Pascal's triangle. So if you have nothing, this is 0, and so 0 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 1 is 2, 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 plus 3 is 6, and so using this, we can generate all possible binomial coefficients. What if you want to form, from a total of n people, j groups of different sizes, not just 2? Well, binomials are made for 2 groups, so you need to use something more powerful. So we'll take the j groups one by one, starting with n1 out of n, then n2 out of the remaining n, and so on up until nj out of the remaining n. And if we look to the right, we see that the factorials actually cancel out, so that we get n factorial divided by n1 factorial, n2 factorial, and so on, nj factorial. And this is the multinomial coefficient. Multinomials are for multiple groups. All concepts seen for binomials generalize to multinomials. As we can see here with simplified trinomials, which replicate Pascal's triangle. In our athlete example, consider 3 additional Brazilian athletes. How many different rankings of their flags are possible? Now, we use flags here because we want to make the order within the group irrelevant. Well, you use the multinomial for 4, 5, and 3 members, and you end up with the answer. You can also see its equivalent in code, where we actually calculate all the different permutations and we count them. If you count only 2 groups, that is excluding Brazilians, then you can see the binomial calculation is actually equivalent to its multinomial counterpart. So as a quick summary, how does one count? Well, let's consider with order and with replacing first. That would mean simultaneous experiments, which is simply n power k. Now, with order but without replacing, then we use n factorial in a complete or partial way. Now, without order, you're probably choosing groups. So use either the binomial for 2 groups or the multinomial for more than 2 groups. Now that you know the techniques of counting, it's time to talk about the set of outcomes we're forming when we count. These sets are the topic of the next lesson.